This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Mark Schumacher. I'm a professor in chief of the Division of Pain Medicine through the Department of Anesthesia and Perioperative Care here at UCSF. Thank you for coming out. I hope to make this and the subsequent sessions of great value to you. I know that pain and pain management is a critical issue for us all and our family members, in our professional lives, in our social lives. And so we put a fair amount of effort and thought into this. And of course, I'll be interested in your feedback after the session. I'll try to remind you as questions come up, if you could jot them down. I've been asked to try to address questions mainly at the end. My talk will be about an hour, maybe a little bit less, so we should have plenty of time. So the title for tonight, or and as it goes forward, is Pain, New Insights, and New, and then we added and old, treatments. And before we launch into a little bit of an advertisement for the next five talks, I just wanted to alert you that there is a public website through our division. It's somewhat easier to remember with the pain.ucsf. And I think you may find some interesting links and information there, as well as to the depth and breadth of pain management. The Department of Anesthesia Division is not the sole owner of pain management at UCSF, and we do our best to collaborate and link to other centers and other areas of expertise. I'm very excited about this series because we really have made an effort to provide an interdisciplinary approach. As you know, there's 1 hour's time is wholly insufficient to try to cover the many factors of a complex issue. And I just wanted to briefly go over the other contributors and encourage you to attend or mention this to your friends. So following this talk next Thursday will be entitled Being Unsympathetic, Psychology's Secret Weapon for Managing Pain by Dr. Jessica Pullins. And of course, what's intended there is not that someone doesn't care, but sympathetic nervous system in particular, and how it impacts pain and how it can be manipulated and modulated to help those that are suffering chronic painful conditions. Following that, Dr. Poiré will be talking about technology versus pain targeted drug delivery and electrical stimulation, clearly not an everyday modality for pain control for many of us, but for some of the most difficult pain conditions, having non-pharmacologic strategies that are using advancing technologies and techniques can sometimes result in a tremendous relief in bringing folks back to some functional level. Following this, Dr. Mari DePinto. Dr. DePinto is our medical director at our Outpatient Pain Management Center, and he'll be talking about essentially my aching neck, my aching back, something hopefully that you won't be complaining about at the end of this talk. But we'll provide some insight to not only our daily struggle sometimes with this malady, which is frankly, one of the most common complaints, lower back pain, for Western civilization. Following this will be Dr. Sanjay Reddy. He's a a professor within the Osher Center, as well as Department of Medicine, and he is speaking on East Meets West, acupuncture beyond for all ages. And he's an active practitioner of acupuncture and other alternative therapies, and we've worked closely together in the medical center. Finally, and perhaps one of the most kind of controversial topics that may come up in this series has to do with the opioid epidemic across the country. Dr. Naidu, who's our medical director for our inpatient pain services, is also now serving as chairman for our pain committee for UCSF, will speak about the prescription opioid epidemic, crisis and opportunity. And I think that's going to be very, very engaging. So as I'm the chair of the series, as also giving your first talk, I will briefly introduce myself just a bit more. So what I'm going to try to do is weave together some fairly complex, some basic science, some clinical application, translational sciences, to try to make a point. I understand that plowing through pain pathways or pharmacology alone will may give us an aching neck and an aching back, but I hope to make it a somewhat engaging, providing a little bit of a historical perspective when appropriate, but really laying a foundation for the subsequent talks as well. So I hope you can stay with me. I have no commercial disclosures. Much of the personal research that may come out is woven in here was supported either through the NIH, some private foundations, or UCSF. So what is pain? And pain is something, of course, we recognize when we see it in someone else, or we certainly can recognize it when it's happening to ourselves. It's a common experience we all share. And it's interesting because it's also very much rooted in the context of when we experience this. Although we may consider pain a sensation, there's quite a range here, and we might think about a headache, we might think about chest pain or back pain, and we might ask ourselves, you know, is this serious? How long might it last? What's driving the pain? And thus comes this interesting juxtaposition of these two pictures. One is a historical picture of someone suffering from headaches several hundred years ago, and then I put the little box in, is the gremlin. And it's amazing that the gremlin shows up in both pictures. The other photo is actually a little picture my son drew some years ago, who suffered from intractable migraines at the time, and his pediatric neurologist asked him to illustrate his headaches. And I think it goes a great distance to illustrate the challenges of pain and pain management, in that it's, you could see the sensation of something going through his temple, making his eyes pop out, coming, bringing him to his knees, really. And what was fascinating to me was that in both cases, there's these strange gremlins seemingly driving the pain. And really what this talk is about is trying to get at what are these gremlins, you know, and how do we get rid of them, basically. Although we may think about, is there a quick medication or fix? Often these gremlins remain somewhat mysterious to us. As much as we've all experienced pain on a personal level, there's societies now that have dedicated their efforts to understanding, and they've come up with certain definitions. Certainly here from the ISP, an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage, or described in those terms. And the key thing here is that it's a both a sensory and an emotional experience, and I'll try to ferret that out for you as we go through some of the neurophysiology and the neuroanatomy. It means that it may be challenging where we go after to try to block one aspect of the pain, but we may not be able to cover the entire experience. What we do know, though, is that at times, if this persists, that it can really take over our lives, leading to a lot of disability. One theme of this talk is to integrate sort of the natural history of the discovery of pain mechanisms in some of their therapeutics. And so one of the great and rather amazing things is the fact that over the millennia, plant derivatives have played such a key role in both the attempts to treat pain, but also has revealed sort of the inner workings of the pain pathway and endogenous analgesic systems. And probably most people realize this is the opium poppy in some sort of day glow purple, but for San Francisco viewing. But nevertheless, our understanding then really intertwines both pharmacology, plants, anatomy, and neurophysiology. And neurophysiology being how the nervous system is responding to these noxious stimuli. And so I'd like to first just acknowledge that, you know, for millennia, opioids and the use of opium has been with the various populations as a means to try to resolve pain. Now, what was interesting is that within opium is the derivative of morphine, which is nearly 10% by weight of the product of opium poppies. However, over time, it revealed that, in fact, we have endogenous chemicals in peptide transmitters, such as endorphins, that stereochemically have a structure very much mimicking these plant derivatives. And so through this, we realize that themes that will come up through this talk is that as we might uncover a particular agent that has been found to be effective, often in parallel, our own nervous systems, our peripheral, our central nervous systems, are emulating plant derivatives in certain chemicals that we've identified that way. So the question may be, have we made really any progress in the pharmacology or pharmacologic treatment of pain? And so you might think back, you know, although opium extracts have been used for millennia, it's just around 1803 that Subturner had actually isolated morphine, and it became used in a clinical way. So back in that time, morphine was certainly a product that started to be used. Now, have we made much progress, right? So here we are, 2016, and I'm afraid we're still seemingly focused on opioids and morphine may be sustained release forms. And I don't mean to downplay their importance. They certainly help many folks in different ways, but it just points out that the predominant analgesics that we still rely on as societies seem to revolve around opioids and morphine. So why is that? Well, what would be an ideal analgesic? And I've listed here some possibilities. As you may see, we would hope that such analgesic could act selectively on so-called pain-sensing nerves, would not depress the central nervous system or depress respiration. If we use it over time, we would not lose its ability. It would maintain its analgesic effect. It'd be easy to administer, is not addictive, and lo and behold, it would be affordable. So the question, of course, is do we have such a compound? The answer is, unfortunately, no, we do not. And you can quickly see that in some cases, we may have some agents that may be affordable or easy to administer, yet they may be addictive, they may depress ventilation, et cetera. So you can see the challenges here. What I'd like to provide is a little optimism that really a revolution is underway, and some of this you may have already read about or heard about over the years. In terms of our understanding of pain medicine and pain pathways, and I was just going to take a few minutes to go back in time to review how this has all come about. So I have a little bit of a timeline. And you know, the use of extracts from hot chili peppers have been with us for probably even 4,000 years BC. But some of the records start pulling it together around 2000 BC. And And so I've thrown in some cases here of ancient pain medicine, let's say. And so here's our first case, a 41-year-old with a 2-year history of increasing joint pain, wrist, elbow, and hands, unable to perform daily work, difficult to sleep due to pain. So I don't know if anyone has guessed who this might be. This was the CEO of the Roman Empire. At least that's the legend, that Caesar Augustus was suffering from arthritis at an early age, and he directed his various entourage and his ancient physicians to go on their campaigns to define local folk or other tribal remedies, as it were, and through these efforts they came across in the Anti-Atlas Mountains in Morocco about this time, and again, I have to, for disclosure, think that there's more records to say that this actually may have fallen on King Juba. And so between the two of them, they came across this area and came across this cactus-like plant called Euphorbia resinifera. And Euphorbos means flesh or corpulous. And this plant, when cut, produces a latex that, when a resin, that when applied to the joints, produce pain relief and presumably relief from arthritis and joint pain. Interestingly enough, this same class of plants is you're aware of is the poinsettia plants that use in the holidays sometimes. But those do not have medicinal properties. I would not apply the caustic latex of a poinsettia plant on your skin. Please do not do that. Nevertheless, completely in another part of the world, in many hundreds of years and thousands of years later, we pick up a record from the Aztecs of the use of hot chili peppers in South America. And we see that, not surprisingly, there are evidence of its use in culinary activities and social. But, the Aztecs were quite somewhat of a disciplined society. And they also knew that if they burned the hot chili peppers, they could produce rather noxious fumes. And this is a little grim, but this looks like the ultimate time out. It looks like some adult holding a child over. So I'm not sure that would quite go so well these days. And there's also something being said by this. I cannot translate that for you. But the good news is that at the same point, there was some compassionate care within the Aztecs. And in fact, they had some fairly accurate record saying of using different pulps from different hot chili pepper to treat things like toothache. And so this is our next case, a 28-year-old male craftsman with severe toothache for a week, unable to work or sleep. And then again, using hot chili pepper pulp to treat pain from a tooth decay, presumably. And this may very well represent the first time of a treatment of neuropathic pain. So one may always been asking, why then is an application of something like a hot chili that we would know, or something from a cactus, could be a possible effective treatment for pain of any sort, much less chronic pain? And so if we compare the two molecules from these two plants and two time points, we find that although they have their parent structures are quite different, one's more of a four-ball structure, another is a conjugate of homovanillic acid, it turns out that their two active groups, the methoxy and hydroxyl group, are in fact the key part that will activate sensory neurons and produce this sort of effect. Moving forward then in the timeline, what's interesting is that not much happened in Christopher Columbus, Ocean Blue, 1492, brought these to Europe, but then not much happened and for a while. As time passed, science developed, and you begin seeing reports of anatomy and analysis past the Renaissance period. Here's a famous drawing from Descartes depicting what he believed was how humans, how we sensed pain, and this involved, you know, a starting some heat or fire, and then this connection up to the brain. And the depiction was very much mechanical. It was like the pathways were like machines, and there was a tracks, there were valves, and it took that approach. And I've put in then some, modern terms, and where the initial heat, noxious heat, is what we would call pain transduction. The conduction up to the brain would be transmission, and then perception. And I'll go into detail of each of these and hopefully convince you of what may be some of our modern interpretation of each of these steps. Just to finish briefly with the history of this, then, as time has been advancing, then starting in the 1900s, modern technology really took hold to scientific investigation. And then Sherrington stepped forward and really established the fields of neurobiology, did some basic studies on nerves and reflexes, and started to coin the terms nociceptor or primary afferent nociceptor, relating specific subtypes of sensory neurons to their responses. Now, compressing time over the last about 100 years or so, you'll see that in the 40s, a Hungarian research group came back and started analyzing the effects of capsaicin, and could somewhat confirm what some of the very earlier activities were around activation and inactivation of sensory nerves. There was other investigators that were confirming Sherrington's initial hypothesis that there were dedicated sensory neurons to detect painful stimuli. And there was further clarification about subtypes of these sensory neurons and so-called C-type or C-polymodal nociceptors that in fact responded to this specific extract of hot chili peppers. The capsaicin receptor was then proposed in the early 70s. So where does that put us in this trajectory? And again, I would just propose we're at this pain transduction starting point and primary afferent nociceptors. Where does pain start? Well, is define a population of sensory neurons that are small diameter. They're either non or thinly myelinated. A subset of these can be activated by this pungent principle in capsaicin. What's interesting then, the next step is that there seems to be three modalities principally: a chemical activation, thermal, and mechanical. And chemical is intended to mean not just the hot chili pepper extract, but other noxious chemicals, acid, things like that. And many of these neurons turned out to be able to detect all three of these modalities. Some may be dedicated mainly to thermal or chemical. So I was fortunate enough to throw, you know, and it's a little bit, you know, of a self-advertisement here, but many years ago now, I was fortunate enough to be part of the group that identified or cloned the target of capsaicin, the so-called capsaicin receptor, or TRPV1 is its scientific name. Here at UCSF, that was in conjunction with Dr. David Julius in his laboratory, in conjunction with Dr. Levine's group. And what was found at that time was that this so-called receptor or pain switch represented a unique member of a family of protein receptors, which multiple transmembrane domains, these cross plasma membranes that are essentially inserted on the terminals of these sensory neurons, nociceptive neurons. And this would represent one of, say, four subunits that together form a pore through the membrane that, when triggered by either noxious or, as we'll discuss, physical stimuli, will cause a depolarization and activation of these specific nociceptors that have been identified over the years. Just to point out, there's a family of these, and they continue to be investigated and explored as their roles, and I'll throw out a few examples later, as they pertain to the detection or developing the persistence of chronic pain. So another part of the interesting aspects of their discovery is that not only do these receptors and some of these family members respond to exogenous things like plant derivatives, but again, much like the example for morphine and the endogenous peptides in that pathway, it turns out that there are endogenous chemicals made mainly from the inflammatory pathways that will also activate these same receptor channels. So if we go back to our picture or depiction from Descartes and focus on transduction, where does pain begin? We may have at some point in our educational process examined sensory transduction and be aware that there's such things as simple touch, there's certain pressure sensors and such, yet we were always puzzled by this the so-called bare nerve ending or the naked nerve ending. And I think, you know, when I first came through this, I always had this feeling that there was these so-called naked sensory terminals that were sort of waving in the wind. There were some are in tissue, and if you bumped into them or somehow damaged near them, they would somehow non-specifically just fire off, and that's how pain got started. Well, it turns out, and I hope to convince you, that in fact, the terminals of these are highly specialized structures, chocked full of these various receptors and members of TRP channels, as well as other proteins that can transduce noxious stimuli into signaling that we eventually interpret as painful. Now, part of the process, of course, and this is much older now published work, was, of course, doing the usual and say, okay, if you think that this is receptor is really, you should be able to reconstitute it into a cellular system, put on various extracts of our kitchen peppers and show, in fact, those that have the highest potency, the feared habanero, would activate or induce a current when you artificially express this in cellular systems. The other part is it in the right place? And so this is a cross-section of a rodent sensory ganglion. These are our sensory ganglion that lie alongside our spinal cord. And if you cut across in a thin section in a microscope and stain for the blueprint, the messenger RNA that encodes this TRPV1, you can see that not all the cells are lighting up or staining, right? There's just some, and basically it's just the small diameter neurons that show the staining here. And so this already starts to pull together the story that there's something very unique about this subpopulation of neurons that express this particular receptor and we believe are dedicated to the detection of painful stimuli. So getting back to this then, why is the application of hot chili extracts effective treatment in pain? We gave those two examples, one the CEO of the Roman Empire, and then the other is a craftsman in the Aztec civilization. So how possibly, and you may have used these yourself, could generate an analgesic effect? And thus far, here is some possible mechanisms, and I think it's a combination of these. Some of you have already used these compounds. Often we think about the application of these as it affects first just the receptor. If I could just show, I don't know if I have that circle, there we go. So this is a system where we express just this channel and repeatedly added capsaicin here. And as you can see, the response after each application, the current response that would be depolarizing the sensory nerve gets smaller and smaller each time. And so you might consider that as desensitization. There's something called dysfunction, and I'll go to the next slide. where increases in intracellular calcium, which normally reside outside of the bit of increase, can cause dysfunction of many of the other functions of those sensory terminals. So even though you mediated it through a particular receptor, you've allowed too much calcium to come in, overwhelming the terminal, and now come in with some other stimulus, that same terminal is not going to respond as it normally would. Many people have probably read and heard about substance P, and I'll get to that, or depletion of substance P, a neuropeptide that's involved in the facilitation of pain signaling in the spinal cord. That is part of it. I don't think it's necessarily the primary reason that you get analgesic effect. But this final one, destruction of the actual terminals, is likely one of the most robust, both a desensitization, dysfunction, and then destruction, at least temporarily, of these nerve terminals. And that, over time, has been found to be one of the more consistent things, where they've done even biopsies and show that loss of these fine terminals, at least temporarily, parallels the analgesic effects of these agents. One can also study and find that, in fact, resinephrotoxin, that extract from the cactus plant years ago, can do the same thing. And in fact, if we fast forward to more current times, one can find the use of these same agents, or at higher concentrations in patch form, being studied to relieve the pain of chronic conditions, neuropathies, some associated with HIV, other from diabetic neuropathy, other with postherpetic neuralgia, for example. But so we get back to then this idea of, now is this going to represent maybe the most ideal target? You know, we're looking at what would be an ideal analgesic in terms of development. Is this something that's not going to depress the nervous system, that could be selective on sensory neurons, et cetera? And so, again, Big Pharma has gone after this for now well over 10 years and looking for ways to block specifically this receptor channel as a potential analgesic target. There's been many studies, but one of the most impressive, somewhat paradoxically, is that although some of the initial agents could be found to be effective analgesics, they ended up producing unique side effects, not the type that we might think about opioids reducing our respiratory rate, but in fact, in this clinical trial, which was a molar extraction and then treating either with the test agent versus like ibuprofen or something like that, a non-steroidal, many, if not most, of the volunteers developed high fevers. And so what's up? And so it turns out that TRPV1 is utilized by our bodies for core temperature regulation. And by blocking that with this particular agent, it uncoupled a core temperature regulation, and these volunteers ended up with high fevers that had to be treated with acetaminophen or ibuprofen. And amazingly, a single dose would last for days. So that pretty much, they pulled the reins in on this particular. Now, there's been subsequent efforts made, and I just, not to pick on just the TRPV1, but this is the challenges of developing what would be ideal analgesic therapy. There's been strategies of dosing, repetitive dosing, to reduce or eliminate the changes in core temperature, for example. And as well, though, there's been other things that have shown up, that some of the products shown in the middle here represent liver difficulties and such. And so the research continues. It may be directed more to very specific indications, going from what was going to be a blockbuster type of analgesic to very focused therapies for perhaps intractable migraines or some other particular indications, from dental pain or rhinitis, and topical applications again. So we've come full circle. So I'd like to move on then to our next step in the process. And that is the so-called transmission. This is where we've taken the various peripheral activation, and again, just to review, mechanical, chemical, and thermal activation of these primary afferents. And these three modalities, again, continue to be used for the study of pain, but also to better exact how to intervene. As we might imagine, pardon me, we may not be necessarily concerned of, you know, reacting to slightly warmer temperatures or colder temperatures, but mechanical stimulation, walking, getting up, taking a deep breath after an operation, those are critical aspects of quality of our life and how they could produce disability. So from the input here of both these three modalities, what we find is that they all feed into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. And this is really a relay center. And it's not a simple switch, but something that starts to integrate this input. So there's not necessarily a direct relationship of the activation of these or the degree of activation and actually the encoding of a painful or perceiving of a painful stimulus. So there's starting to be modulation and encoding that occurs at the cord and at higher levels. What I have shown here is then the so-called ascending track where, and again, this is a very oversimplified diagram, but the important part is that after crossover and ascending to the so-called spinal thalamic track, just be aware, and you'll see this again, is that there's really two tracks that bring this information up. There is the so-called neospinal thalamic track, which works its way up to, most people realize, the thalamus in a posterior. So that gives you somatotopic, you recognize there's been a noxious event, you kind of know where it is in the body. But not shown here is something called the paleo, the older track. And that goes right into other areas in the midbrain, limbic area, areas that are known to drive emotion and are involved with motor planning and such. So both of these are going in parallel, and I'll reinforce this idea, how then both attention, arousal, emotion, these are hardwired into the noxious the processing of noxious stimulus in our nervous system. Therefore, it may be no surprise then the difficulty is sometimes to manage pain or to find a particular agent that could both block the nociception part as well as all the other aspects of the processing. Getting back to an example about the modulation of pain by opioids, I just wanted to point out that in this same pathway, as nociceptive information is processed and is ascends, opioids can help block or modulate both at the periphery in the dorsal horn and also as it ascends. And again, this is an impressive point, is that we might think about opioids causing cognitive dysfunction. I feel the pain, but I don't care so much. But in fact, it plays an important role to actually limit the intensity and the coding of the pain signaling, both on the ascending, as we'll see, enhancing a descending inhibitory program as well. Just a quick close-up of the spinal cord, this dorsal horn region. There's a lot going on here. We don't really have that much time to go into detail, but you can find opioid receptors, the mu opioid receptors, both in the presynaptic and the postsynaptic part of this dorsal horn relay. But a lot of other things are going on. There's activation from noxious stimuli that can cause release of excitatory amino acid glutamate, which can land on the so-called NMDA receptor, and we'll give a clinical example about that. But also there's the substance P release and the many other aspects here. But again, this is a key area that involves in the first step of plasticity. That is, and this is something we're still trying to understand, but under repeated activation of the nociceptive pathway, you start getting facilitation, easier and easier for this neurotransmitter to be released. Terms you might have heard of, wind up or sensitization, that we'll discuss. And this is thought to be perhaps this transition from acute to chronic painful conditions involve this step as well. And then finally, the descending pathway, and many of you may not have read about this yet, but again, this involves descending inhibitory pathways that largely land down again into this dorsal horn region, and they can be modulated by opioids and endogenous opioid systems that enhance this descending inhibition down to the dorsal horn here. Aberrations, abnormalities in terms of the nervous system, as well as cognitive abnormalities, people with anxiety disorders, with catastrophizing, can end up inadvertently removing this kind of inhibitory process, and is thought to be one of the aspects that could cause persistent pain problems and linking both cognitive and midbrain function to actual nociception. So finally, perception. I'll say a few words. Again, we could spend the week talking about pain perception, but here's a fairly complicated slide for you from Donald Price. But again, I just show this to point out there's really ascending information really goes two ways. One, coming up to what would be the thalamus, the VPL, but also into limbic areas like the amygdala, other more primitive areas, the hypothalamus. And again, it turns out that these work in parallel to both identify the location of the noxious stimulus, but also immediately start to plan a motor response, escape, some sort of behavioral response to this information. And so again, it's no surprise that as we might plan to develop unique analgesic strategies, once we're at the level of perception in these intricate networks, it'll be very difficult to go after specifically somatotopic when if you've enraged the emotional pathways and other aspects of it. More practically, we might consider what influences the severity of pain. And again, this will touch on what Dr. Pullins will go into, not only in explaining the pathways, but also some actual up-to-date therapies and how to modulate painful stimuli, both acute and chronically. But psychologically, catastrophizing, feelings of helplessness, or so-called cognitive distortions, as I mentioned, can influence that midbrain circuitry, removing the normal inhibitory descending pathways, and leading to exaggerated perceptions of pain from noxious input. Clearly, pain is complex. As I mentioned at the very beginning, the context of pain, there's a social aspects of it and its meaning in the terms of either whether it's on the battlefield or in the hospital. These are dramatically different contexts of this. But there's also, of course, biological, the patient, you know, a person's physical condition, the context of the disease progress or not, whether medications are on board and how they influence that, as well as I keep stressing, these endogenous analgesic systems. So taken as a whole, then, it's this combination from transduction, transmission, and perception in which we approach both understanding our pain, but also strategies for its treatment. So I wanted then to finish up in the next 15, 20 minutes to, again, using this story of the capsaicin receptor, trippy one a little bit, as a segue into this idea of now we have a better understanding about acute pain detection, whether that's chemical, mechanical, or thermal. We haven't really given a lot of examples or other ion channels that are involved. But we're all here probably to understand, you know, what do we do to avoid acute pain turning into chronic pain conditions? Or we may know somebody who is suffering, or we ourselves have been struggling with certain chronic painful conditions. And so there's starting to be some insight, I think. We're not quite there, but I'd like to throw out some information, some research, as well as some ideas and where the field is headed. So coming back to TRIP B1 and peripheral inflammation, we know inflammation has the four, the dolor, rubor, pallor, and tumor, and that's, you know, somewhat expected. It's generated by local infiltration of neutrophils, production of inflammatory mediators, prostaglandins, and increased blood flow. So we're familiar with that. What's interesting is that there's a very strong link between the inflammatory response, inflammatory pain, and the actual expression and function of this capsaicin receptor, TRPV1, both in the side of mainly thermal hyperalgesia, but also even potentially mechanical. So what happens from acute to persistent pains, especially under inflammatory conditions? And the work from Michael Katerina, as well as another group, using mice that had a knockdown, that is a reduction of the amount of this TRPV1 made in the nervous system. If we superimpose sort of those findings with essentially information we know from human studies, we can know that if there's an inflammatory event, and then that could be like a sunburn, for example, it'll shift the response. These sensory neurons will start to fire at lower thresholds. So we've all may have had a sunburn, we get into the shower, and then suddenly the warm water feels very hot. And so this idea of sensitization or hyperalgesia is something you can think of, generally speaking, under injury conditions, and if there's a pathologic process, how that could really make most people quite miserable. What's interesting is that the reduction of this particular receptor will completely eliminate thermal hyperalgesia. So there's a strong link between this capsaicin receptor, but moreover, it gives us more insight on how acute to chronic pain may be established and how it's maintained and perhaps how it could be reversed or blocked. So here's just a quick slide from some research we did in our own lab where we took a transgenic mouse that only made half, like 50% of this TRPV1, and how it responded to some edema in the paw. And you can see under control conditions, there's maybe swelling up to around 25%. The mouse, it's like kind of a mild sunburn in terms of their behaviors, but you can see reduction of TRPV1. The paw doesn't hardly swell at all. So there's a strong link here in relationship to some of these channels and receptors like TRPV1 and even the inflammatory response, as much less the painful response we've been talking about. So if we look at how this would feed into the great range of what we might consider chronic painful conditions, things from inflammatory states, from arthritis, bladder dysfunction, bowel disease, ischemic disease patterns, nerve injury, diabetes, HIV, neuropathy, postherpetic neuralgia, spine and back pain, and traumatic or postoperative pain syndromes. Again, there's quite a range here. What's the relationship of these potential peripheral channels or the channels that are expressed in our central nervous system to either detect or then end up driving persistent pain problems? Does that make any sense? So in this cartoon, in the simplest state, we'll say that there's some activation, there's some injury to the tissue. Here are our nociceptive terminals. Here's our sensory ganglion out here. And it turns out that, again, this is a fairly complex overlapping system. Pain is thought to be something that provides our attention to preserve the organism. And so it's not surprising that there's not a single pathway for its activation. There's many redundant systems also a principal reason it may be so difficult to develop a single agent to take care of the whole thing. That said, in addition to the injury and the immediate activation of these neurons, at the same time, there starts to be plasticity changes in the neuronal cell bodies in the ganglion, the sensory ganglion, as well as other parts of the nervous system. So I'm just going to go through here and show that there's in the most complicated slide I may have here is that after injury, there's product synthesis like prostaglandins, productions of inflammatory mediators. There's modification of these channel receptors, that is, enter their secondary messenger system that may make these channels more sensitive to just non-noxious stimuli. And there's the start of a longer term changes in transcription and gene expression that start to rewire the peripheral sensory and central system into a pathologic condition. So what would that look like? So in the case of TRPV1, we already have evidence, for example, that if we had some injury, normally we might have, as the slightly covered slide shows, some level of baseline expression of these channels or receptors that we would normally want available for detection of pain. However, over time or persistent injury or inflammation, now we end up with an overexpression of these, and for some reason, a feed forward. And one of the hypotheses or ideas is that persistent pain states represent a dysregulation and abnormal changes in gene expression. In some cases, it may be the upregulation of pronociceptive pathways and receptors. In other, it might be a downregulation of endogenous analgesic systems or molecules. As I mentioned before, central sensitization is another potential trigger for acute to chronic. And again, this has to do with the abnormalities in this dorsal horn region of processing. Central sensitization have been known to be mediated by the NMDA receptor. But again, these other channels that I've just described have been more and more identified as also active players under persistent inflammatory conditions. I'd like you to then, it's a little bit in-depth neurobiology and pharmacology. I want to just take a step back to really underline the importance of some of these pathways and our growing ability to use some of this knowledge in clinically relevant situations, and I have a couple for you. And this is a case that's many years ago now that I was involved with, and this was an unfortunate 22-year-old woman with recurrent AML who was status post bone marrow transplanted, developed graft versus host disease, essentially the body's attacking itself, and ended up with essentially an 80% would be a burn, the total skin breakdown, both externally, internally, massive GI bleeding. But she was totally neurologically intact, and everything was being done to save her. We were called through the consult service that she had been on escalating, increasing doses of fentanyl, one of our most potent opioid analgesics, of about 100 times more potent than morphine, for example. And we were called because although she was starting to suffer renal dysfunction and liver dysfunction, she was actually on a tremendous amount. She was on 7,000 micrograms an hour. So she was getting 3.4 liters of fentanyl a day in an attempt to control her pain, yet she was wide awake. She was actually getting fluid overloaded by this amount of fentanyl. And so there was this hard to believe that this was true, and in fact it was. What we did, and really for UCSF was sort of the first time we introduced this, was start a so-called very low dose infusion of ketamine. Again, ketamine is a NMDA receptor antagonist. And remember that slide I showed you in that dorsal horn One of the principal receptors for glutamate from the excitatory nociceptive pathway. And we also know NMDA receptors are a site of wind-up and sensitization. They also are strongly linked, we don't know why, to opioid receptor, mu opioid receptor function. And there had been at the time some reports in Europe that low-dose concentrations could actually stop the progression of opioid tolerance as well as try to reverse or stop this sensitization, this severe pain this patient was. And amazingly, we started this infusion. There you can see at the peak here for this line was several weeks of an infusion. And she went from being wide awake and could, even though intubated and ventilated, could communicate, she was in severe pain, to gradually falling asleep. And then we started going down on the dosing. And she woke up several days later, relatively comfortable, despite her ongoing process. Fortunately, she was able to turn the corner, and she, in fact, we were able to completely wean her off the fentanyl, and she made it out of the ICU. This is a very dramatic, extreme example, but something to really anchor this idea that CNS sensitization pathways and also the limitation of opioid therapy in terms of development of tolerance in me start working against. Another case, more recently, was a 19-year-old young woman who suffered from a desmoid tumor, who had undergone many different therapies and palliations. Unfortunately, she was readmitted and wasn't doing well, had increasing pain, fullness, abdominal pain that limited her quality of life. And so she returned to us several times with essentially uncontrolled pain despite escalation of opioids. And I'm sorry, that's a little small, but an analog or a slightly different version of morphine called hydromorphone, her requirements now had climbed to 300 milligrams of IV hydromorphone a day. She became constipated, and again, we were able to start this very low-dose ketamine infusion, as well as some other therapies, and from that, we were rapidly able to reduce her requirements dramatically from 300 down to 20 milligrams, start feeling better, and then we could consider also transfer to hospice. What was really an amazing part of this story was that one of her wishes was that she would go to Disneyland with her sister, her younger sister. But at the time, there was no practical way. However, with the initiation of this low-dose ketamine, we went from hospital-based to a little backpack. And this picture is as her sister heading out with her from her hospice program to Disneyland. And actually, they went with her sister with the disease had a portable device that infused this low-dose ketamine as well as some of the opioid, and they were able to spend the day together with her family. So again, lessons learned in trying to bring, you know, the humanity into this talk a little bit is that the research that goes on in this direction may seem a little bit esoteric, but you just need one or two of these examples to understand that at times, not only will you come across agents or ways to use them that might you think be limited to the hospital, but here's something that went from a drug that's typically thought of as an anesthetic at higher doses, but that could be used at much lower doses in a somewhat sophisticated way that allowed someone to have a vastly improved quality of life. So, and then moving on then, just for completion's sake, is about supraspinal modulation. And I think I've mentioned that again, this, just as we've talked about sensitization in the periphery, we've talked about sensitization in the dorsal horn, spinal cord, these same changes can be occurring in midbrain levels, okay? And we believe that there can also be changes like gene expression changes that can lead to challenges. So in the last, I'll just go another 5 minutes or so. And I wanted to kind of leave with you, one, some what's going on in a practical sense. You know, I don't want to give you the impression that low-dose ketamine is a routine type of therapy by any means, but it provides, I think, a brilliant example of when it can work under unusual conditions. On the same hand, I also wanted to stress that sometimes certain medications that are perhaps right under our nose, if we use them in combination, we can avoid toxicity of monotherapy, just escalating one agent over everything else. And this has really been brought out with the use of agents for perioperative care, and in particular joint replacement arthroplasty. And so we've developed several years ago a program that involves work with our orthopedic colleagues, where we introduce a so-called multimodal analgesic therapy, where not only do patients get just spinal anesthetics and a peripheral nerve catheter following their, we do everything we can to reduce the need or use of opioids, and this includes acetaminophen at a maximal dose, a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory agent, celecoxib here, and a anti-seizure medication, urontin, that some people, or gabapentin, pregabalin, that is sort of a membrane stabilizer. Interestingly enough, in using this preoperatively and continuing postoperatively, within our own population, comparing before and after we started this program, we were able to reduce hospital length of stay by at least a day, earlier mobilization, and essentially eliminate the use of IV opioids. And so again, I just pointing out many of the agents that I've talked to you about tonight represent agents that have been around for a while, but again, our utilization of them and how we might use them in combination can make all the difference in the world. So how do we limit the transition from acute to chronic pain? Well, I think there's a lot of people working on that. That's certainly probably was going to generate a Nobel Prize for someone. But I just wanted to leave with you a last two ideas here. One is that you know, our nervous systems are probably not designed for all things. They were probably designed for a recognition of acute injury, but one has to ask ourselves, were they really designed for what you would consider almost unsurvivable events in the past? Thoracotomies, chest openings, high concentrations of toxic agents, as in chemotherapies. So we have advanced our therapies and improved vastly our survival. However, in doing so, I think we at times have damaged our peripheral nervous systems in the meantime, and we are woe to find therapies to help remedy that situation and ensure any particular survivor's quality of life. And so this is the challenge, I think, that physicians and patients and everyone faces. How do we manage this currently? Well, it's an interdisciplinary multimodal approach. It involves everything at our disposal, from psychological treatments, which you'll hear about, physical restorative therapies, pharmacologic management, and interventions, which we'll also hear about in subsequent weeks. I would have to propose, and this is an area of as transparency for my own research direction, is that as much as we might think about ways to block acute pain signaling, we need to start thinking about long-term changes to the nervous system to try to intercept this to chronic pain. And I believe that involves strategies for interfering with gene expression. And the last couple slides I'll just show you is that one thing that we've come across is that tissues, whatever tissue that is in the body, in development have been differentiated based on transcription factors. That is, these are nuclear factors that direct a cell to become a liver cell, or a muscle cell, or a neuronal cell, or in the case of sensory neurons, as we show here, if we were to apply capsaicin, only a subpopulation of those neurons actually will be expressing that and respond. Others will not. What distinguishes that is these nuclear transcription factors, which have been involved in their early on in their development, but again play a role under injury conditions. Nevertheless, our lab is also trying to be at the forefront of this idea, and again using the TRPV1 capsaicin receptor as a model and the gene that expresses that in sensory neurons, we have identified certain targets and furthermore identified agents that have been used previously, some for even cancer chemotherapy, as ways that could interrupt the expression of the capsaicin receptor. And so we're at the early phases of this, but we're very excited about this. In this case, the idea that we can take a dish of neurons and apply this agent, and what's shown here is the control versus, and we can reduce the number of neurons that express to TRPV1 receptor without really damaging just the whole population, without changing the threshold of normal sensory function. So we're optimistic that as we continue and other labs do, that and we contemplate advances that we've made over the years and over the millennium, that we can transition, of course, from this mechanical model shown here from Descartes to really harness our understanding of transduction, our transmission, to further prevent acute transitions from acute to chronic pain, and hopefully one day further reduce the needless suffering of many folks. So thank you for your attention, and I can take some questions. Way in the back, and I'll repeat the question.
I may have missed something because I came in a little bit late, but in the middle of the talk, you put up a photograph, a slide of a very inflamed skin area, and there was a pimple or some kind, and I did not understand the relationship of that particular slide other than the fact of this inflammation.
Sure. So the question was in the middle of the talk, and I'm sorry I didn't make that clear. There was a slide showing essentially a pimple or some possibly infection or an inflammation with the raised skin wheel, the heat, the pain associated. What's the relationship of that to essentially the whole talk and especially TRPV1? So inflammatory pain, as you know, is a broad challenge for its management, and it was intended to be an example of inflammation in general that overlaps with things like arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, things like that. What you might have missed is the introduction of that is it turns out that as much as we understand inflammation can be driven by enhanced neutrophil infiltration, prostaglandin synthesis, vasodilation, increased blood flow. The pain from inflammatory conditions like that, a large part is mediated by the TRPV1 or the capsaicin receptor. And so if we are to at least experimentally reduce that channel target, we can actually reduce the magnitude of the inflammatory response, and we think reduce the pain and persistent inflammatory pain as well. So it was intended to as a segue. Now, all of that is in development. We do not yet have an effective agent that does not uncouple core temperature regulation, but the concept is that despite injuries, which will always occur, is there a way to intervene in the periphery to block the response, local response, or the neuronal sensory response to that in inflammation. Does that help at all? Yeah.
Mr. Schumacher?
Yes.
Can you explain again the mechanisms of the TRPV1, how you send after the block receptor?
Right. So the question was, could I try to explain how to block the TRPV1 receptor? Right. I didn't I'll tell you what I'll do. Let me just go back and I'll pull up a slide with a picture that should help. One moment. There we go. So as it turns out, activation of these channels, especially this one, and I didn't do a lot of detail about how these channels subunits are activated, but I'll briefly review it now. So the TRPV1 channel is really an integrator of noxious stimuli. And that means that things like low pH that might occur under inflammatory or infectious conditions, under elevated temperatures, or temperatures that are even normal physiologic temperatures, but under inflammatory conditions where endogenous agents working on the intracellular site. So activation of TRPV1 actually occurs chemically from the intracellular side of the cell. So you can imagine that if a particular cell type or neuron has been damaged or inflamed and is producing local eicosanoids, that could then bind to and partially modulate or activate the receptor. These are really cellular receptors, which are then connected to our nervous system that we can detect as a painful stimulus. So how do you block these agents? It would be an agent that would have to cross the membrane. And although I don't have a picture of it, imagine there are four of these forming kind of a donut hole in the middle, which would be the ion channel pore going through the membrane. And on the intracellular side, at least the strategy is so far, that an antagonist, something that could block and prevent this basically response of calcium or sodium going through the channel and depolarizing it. So it's intended to locally block the channel activation. TRPV1's unusual because it can be activated by protons. It can be activated, and I think, let's see if I have another, picture here, but I kind of blasted through this. Let me just find one other picture that might help you. Well, let's see here. Right, so again, we went through this point where there was an injury, but I don't know if you can see, and I know you'll have access to the handouts and all, but the concept here is that TRPV1 is part of a neighborhood of other channels. Some are coupled to secondary messenger systems that are activated under inflammatory conditions, things like the bradykinin pathway, ATP released from injured cells, that sort of thing. And under this sort of perfect storm that often can be reflected by inflammation, we would normally think of a reduction of threshold activation of this nociceptor. Now, instead of 43 or 44 degrees centigrade, now body temperature 37 degrees or 40 degrees can activate and activate this pathway. And so that's one idea of how this could be part of a persistent pain problem. To say, well, you know, I'm planning not to rub hot chili peppers on me, will I be okay? The idea is that these channels, these receptors, are responding to endogenous inflammatory chemicals that look like capsaicin. They lower threshold for activation. That energy, heat energy, comes from our bodies for this particular channel. There are other channels that are not gated by heat, but can be activated by these endogenous inflammatory mediators. Did that help at all? Yes.
I'd be fascinated with the evolution of this, the nociceptors. Are they found in invertebrates?
Right, so the question is, it may not be surprising that, we have a fairly advanced system. How far back do you need to go to find similar nociceptive or sensory neurons that are dedicated to pain? Now, we think about pain, and I think as we get to more primitive organisms, it's difficult to say an organism can suffer or is experiencing pain, but clearly they can withdraw. And impressively, you can go down to the level of worms, small zebrafish, Drosophila flies, and find that you find the same analogs or orthologs of these channels in a little bit more simpler way expressed in a subset of sensory neurons. These have been identified in so-called C. elegans, like the worm, where the ability of a worm to retract or essentially wiggle away from a hot probe is in fact also related to the same family of channels, of trip channels. And there are other examples as well. Yes?
Biomechanical model
of thinking about pain. How would you characterize what transition works? Oh, right. So the question is transition away from a, and maybe I didn't describe this so well, a biomechanical model. I meant in that case, from Descartes, his depiction of tubes and, valves and such, rather than neurobiology, neurophysiology. So sorry to confuse you on that. Where are we trending to? That is the good question. I think that my own opinion is that a lot of effort has gone into looking for specific targets, individual targets, and it has been great, very frustrating, I think, for scientists, physicians, big pharma, when all the efforts have gone into a single target and we've ended up with very unusual side effect profiles. I think that going after networks of targets may have a better success, for example, and that's, I'm a bit biased, that's the direction I'm taking around the transcription factor idea, is that you can find some targets that control several nociceptive genes or targets as way, you may have a better effect or find a compound that can cross a number of barriers. You may not have to use tremendously high doses to try to suppress one thing, but if you can hit many targets at modest levels, the network effect may have a very positive effect. And I think we're seeing that even with our own established agents, as I introduced about multimodal therapies of coming at inflammatory pathways in different ways. It seems like we, even despite the limitations, we've made a step forward with approaching multimodal therapy. So the direction I would say is for some of us maybe familiar with cancer chemotherapy, these are cocktails and medications to go after different aspects of the pathway. I suspect that the direction we're really going to be taking is expanding that idea to pain therapy. Whereas rather than expecting that a single medication at increasingly higher and higher doses is going to be effective without side effects, we're going to come after various painful conditions in a similar way. We'll have strategies of using essentially cocktails of multimodal, multiple, but at modest dosing that could have synergistic effects. That is, they have not simply additive effects, but they have a much greater impact than simply the sum of their effects. Other questions? Yes?
Yeah, I understand, or I've read, I believe, somewhere that an itch is a form of pain. And if that is so, does it follow the same process as this?
Sure. So the question was, in a few minutes, what's the relationship of itch and pain? I don't think that relationship is simple. There are certain receptor subtypes, some that are coupled to these TRIP channels, not just TRPV1, but others that have been identified to mediate itch. And I would say that's an active area of research, because as we all know, that this is clinically in our lives, a huge issue, not only for those that suffer certain dermatologic maladies, but just the association side effects of other medications. So I'm sorry I don't have specifics for you, because I don't want to overstate the importance of any one paper in this area, but it's actively being investigated and apparently related to a degree to some of these same TRIP channels has been investigated, as well as other non-TRIP channels, that actually are related to the thrombin receptors, as it turns out, if you follow that at all. In particular, some that have been focused on certain bile acids, people that have suffered from certain types of liver conditions where their biliary content is high and they have a severe itching, for example. So one is looking into that now, but I don't believe we have any new agents, you know, ready to use there. Yes. I couldn't quite hear you. Capsaicin? Ketamine. Oh, I'm sorry. How does ketamine, yeah. So again, I don't want to overstate the ketamine story here, but as an example of an agent that has primarily effects on the so-called NMDA and N-methyl-D-aspartate receptor, there appears to be a broader points of contact of that compound. What are the real limitations? Well, first, how does it, you know, do that? It's still a little bit of a black box, the relationship of that receptor to opioid function. But we see the phenomenon both in clinical, you know, settings, as I described, as well as other bench science experiments. You know, the hand-waving black box explanation is that these systems, like that receptor and some of the mu opioid receptors, they're not necessarily living in different parts of the city. They're on these so-called lipid rafts, so they're kind of biological machines that work and are coupled together. And it's thought, and one idea is that inhibition of that can restore coupling of a mu opioid receptor function and its normal secondary messenger system coupling to ion channels that are supposed to be working to hyperpolarize cells or block calcium channels. I know that's not a very satisfactory answer, but basically we don't know exactly. But again, I just want to make sure you understand that there's great limits of using some of these agents, just like the others. Higher concentrations can lead to so-called psychomimetic effects that people are probably likely, you know, hallucinations, feeling of floating and such. So we tend to reserve these agents under, you know, more somewhat desperate or difficult situations. Let's see where we're at. So someone who hasn't asked.
Has the molecular structure of TRPV1 actually been defined? And if so, it seems to me you could make a design of drug or antibodies to it.
Yes, so the question was, has the structure been, and so the crystal structure has been identified for certain portions of the molecule. Intracellular domains, for example, the domains that are thought to interact and form as a multiple subunit, at least the simplest model is four subunits, and which then would define a binding pockets for drugs or antagonists. And so the answer is yes. And again, but despite that information, there's been some real limitations, as I've mentioned, with some of the initial study compounds that have going through clinical trials, at least is what has been published. And so, again, starting with the idea of uncoupling core temperature regulation, but also possibly hepatic dysfunction, other unexpected side effects. And again, I think as these analgesic strategies are developing, we'll shift away from the idea of respiratory depression, addiction, things like that, to other sort of adverse, potentially effects, but maybe dose limiting and maybe acceptable under certain conditions for pain management. Did that help at all? Yeah, I'm sorry. The answer is yes, but let's wait and see. I think we're going to call it quits. Thank you so much for your attention. I hope you'd enjoy and come back next week.